Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Tilson Live. It is Tuesday. It is 2 o'clock. We are live on YouTube and live on Facebook as we are each and every single week, talking about all things building a home on your land. I'm Eric Allard, part of the fourth generation of the Tilson family, joined as I am each and every single week by the great, the marvelous, magnificent Don Dantzler, Vice President of Marketing and Customer Experience for Tilson Homes. Good afternoon, Don.
Hey, Eric, how's it going?
It's going great. It's going great. Yeah, we are here, folks. We are talking all things build on your land. We are live on Facebook, live on YouTube. It is Tuesday. It's 2 o'clock. We're going to get into it. We want to answer your questions. The whole point of this show is for y'all to hop in and all of the lingering questions, thoughts, fears, everything you is gobbled up in your brain about building a home on your land. How does it happen? What's the next step? What am I supposed to do? What should I be afraid of? What are the hidden costs? What if somebody tells me this? Who inspects it? How do I get a septic tank? Whatever. That's why we're here. So where our job is to remove all those unknowns for you, make you very familiar with the process, give you guys as much information as you possibly need. So as we do each and every single week, jump into the chat. We want to know where you're building, what part of the process you're in, where you are watching from. We love hearing where you're watching from. We've got Okinawa, Japan, that's out there, Belgium sometimes. I know there's people from Texas, a lot of them. But yeah, where you're watching from, where you're building, what part of the process you are in. Maybe you're just starting this journey and you've got a lot of questions. This community is here to help you. We're here to help you. And then you got people in the community in the chat that will help you out. Maybe you're already, you know, you've begun your journey and you've maybe selected a plan or two, but maybe you're still making some changes, dealing with one of the sales consultants. Maybe you're in the financing part. How do we get this thing paid for? What is easy buy? What's a construction loan? Or maybe you have signed your contract and you are moving the train down the tracks. Maybe you've done your site evaluation. You've met one of our land preparation specialists out there. We've helped you get it laid out. Maybe you're under construction, or maybe you're finished. You've been through the whole journey and now you're just sitting there watching us in the comfort of your beautiful living room or back porch or whatever. So we want to hear from you. Ask any questions you want to ask about building on your land. Drop into the chat where you're watching from, where you're building, what part of the process you're in. And while y'all are doing that, Dawn is going to tell us what in the world we're talking about today, at least what we're initially talking about.
So we're gonna try to talk about the thing that actually makes built on your lot the most difference from building in a production subdivision or buying, you know, just buying a house from, you know, a typical production builder, and that is the land prep. So you've bought this beautiful beautiful piece of property, or you inherited it or whatever, but we got to get it ready to build a house on it. And what does that look like? What types of documents do you need? What kind of work needs to be done? All that good stuff that goes into creating that home and making that land ready for it.
Yeah, so it is the true differentiator of building on your land. So all the stuff we're talking about today, when you walk into that production subdivision, or maybe you've done that before, maybe you've bought a home, you know, in a master plan community or whatever, and that's great, that's cool, but every single thing we're going to talk about today was done for you before you ever even turned into that subdivision and walked into that sales trailer or model home. So, but it's a big part of what we are going to have to help you with when you're building a home on your land. Good news. We've been doing it for 92 years. So we're very, very good at it. We can show you some, I think the kids call it hacks. We can show you some hacks on how to do this. You know, there's some, we can save you some headache and heartache. We can do that for you. Mm-hmm. All you gotta do is ask, or we're gonna take you through the presentation. But do jump into the chat, folks. Tell us where you're watching from, where you're building, what part of the process you're in. We love to hear from you. And also any burning questions you have about building a home on your land. Any products you've seen come up, anything that Pinterest has served you as an ad, excuse me, that you've seen on Pinterest or one of the other socials, the Instagram, perhaps you've seen something, or maybe you said something out loud and now you're seeing it on the Instagram. So these things happen by design. So anyway, jump in, tell us where you're watching from, where you're building, part of the process you are in. We are going to talk about all things site preparation. It is the integral part of build on your land. So we'll talk utilities, we'll talk septic, we'll talk water wells, we'll talk gas, we will talk culverts, we'll talk all of the things that are involved that have to be done before we can build your beautiful home. So, Dawn, with that, folks are jumping in and joining us a little bit. Let's see who we got, and then let's get into the presentation.
Absolutely. All right, we've got Jason who's joining us over on Facebook. Hey, guys. Hey, Jason. Good to see you again. Jason? We've got Christian. Howdy from Lisa and Christian Sumner, building in Bridal Gate in Bandera. The finish line is in sight as closing is imminent within 45 days. Awesome. That's great. Wait. We've got Peter and Pamela in Vancouver, Washington. Nice. We'll be building in Lufkin within a couple of years. Awesome.
That's a Venn diagram that does not have a lot of overlap. I can tell you that. I got kinfolks from Lufkin, Texas, and people going from Vancouver, Washington to Lufkin, Texas. That is a very small Venn diagram. Very small. Glad to have you.
We've got Misty. He says, hello from Mansfield, building the San Jacinto XL in Hood County. The stone is going on the front. Drywall is finishing inside, and cabinets are forecasted for the 29th. Wonderful. That's great. Amazing. Coming right along.
Nice. Welcome, Misty.
We've got Gina meeting with Talon this Saturday on firming our plan, hoping to sign a contract. This has taken over a year. We are scared and nervous at the same time.
You're in great hands, Gina. You are in great hands. We know you've been watching all the shows. You know what to ask. You've asked all the right questions. You're going to be great. Talon, you're in great hands with Talon and the whole team there in San Marcos. So
yep.
You're in good shape.
And she's going to be building in B County. So going to a great place. Yeah. And then we have, I guess, an anonymous person from YouTube. We're about 3 to 4 weeks from signing a contract. Thanks to Zoshi and Melissa, building in Navarro County, Richland Chambers,
of course.
With a modified LaSalle. Awesome.
Oh, beautiful. That'll be really nice on the lake.
Yeah,
oh,
that's nice. Going to be really nice and pretty. And Jason is saying that they can be neighbors in Lufkin. So Peter and Pamela, you got a neighbor already built in.
I think we just finished one there too.
Yeah, and then we've got Aristotle saying, what's up, fam?
Hey, what's up, Mr. Ponder? Thanks for joining us. We appreciate that. All right, so folks, obviously keep jumping in. Tell us where you're watching from, where you're – oh, the anonymous. They removed the anonymity.
Anonymous is Dean and Pat from Prosper.
Hey, I can appreciate the anonymity on YouTube. So, yeah, Dean and Pat from
Prosper. I'm trying to figure out how you did it. So
moving from Prosper down to Richland Chambers, that's really, really cool. So I can remember when Prosper was, like, north of nowhere. Like when we built our design center in Melissa, Texas, that like Prosper was the hinterlands. And that is not the case anymore. Prosper's big time. So
yeah,
obviously it doesn't stop here, folks. Drop your questions into the chat. We still want to know where you're building, what part of the process you're in, where you're watching from, and any questions you have about building on your land. It could be site preparation related. That's cool. We'll probably answer them during the presentation. Ask them anyway. Mm-hmm. But any other things you have, you want to talk about financing, you want to talk about design changes, you want to talk about construction, you want to talk about expectations, timeframes, interest rates, any of that kind of stuff, we will talk about it. So let's get into it. Let's talk about developing the land for building a home. What are we going to talk about, Dawn?
So we're going to cover a little bit of everything. Like we said, all the land prep. Just for anybody who's new here, we're going to go into a little of Tilson history and just kind of define built on your lot, kind of talk about why you should listen to us and why we know what we're talking about. We're going to talk about some pre-construction responsibilities because there's a lot of things that need to be done before we can even think about building your home. So that's really what we're focusing on. So talking about the important documents that you're going to need, all that paperwork and good stuff, what types of utilities and how we get those connected, how we plan for site access, and then kind of planning out your job site, where your home's going to go, and all the preparation things that go into it.
That's exactly right. Who are we?
So the first is just who we are. And if you're new and you're just joining us, this is who you're talking to, just so you know. We have over 90 years experience building in Texas, and we are the most experienced rural home builder that there is in the state. Founded in 1932, Texas family owned and operated for four generations. Eric is the fourth generation, and the fifth generation is anxiously waiting to dethrone him and take over. So
I'm down.
I've met them. They're super smart. Yep. We have built over 40,000 homes throughout the state of Texas on our customers' own land. That's all we do is built on your lot. We don't do any of the you know, selling the land with the house thing. We don't do that. And on average, around 10 families per week are moving into their new Tilson home. So this is all we do, folks. We only do it in Texas. So we are the experts in the area. And that's why you should. That's why we're talking about it and why you should listen to us.
Yeah, there's the street cred.
Yeah. So when we're talking about built on your lot, you know, it means exactly that. It's your land. It's your lot, your land, your farm or ranch, sometimes it's a retirement or a second site. It's your lake property, you know, whatever. It's your land. You're bringing the land to this equation. We're going to put the house on that property for you. And it's really all about having the home of your choice built on your site. And that's what we mean when we use that phrase. So. But there are going to be, like you talked about, some pre-construction responsibilities. We are going to help you out as much as we can. So as much as we can do, we are going to do. But the operative word in built on your land is your. So it's your property. There are going to be some things that we cannot do just legally because you own it and we don't. So a few things that are going to need to get done that you're going to have to kind of take the lead on, and we'll help you as we can, but you're going to probably be the one needing to do some of it, is getting a 911 address. So if there's never been anything built on this property before, you're going to need to register it with the county, get that address. And that just protects everybody in case, you know, something should happen. We have the ability for emergency services to find that property, and that'll help us during construction, and it'll help you when you live there. The next thing is going to be the utility setups. So you're going to be the one that's going to need to open those accounts, because in most cases it's going to require granting easements. So again, it's your property. We can't give someone else the right to access it and to have an easement on it without you. So we're going to need you to take the lead in setting that up. We'll get you all the contacts, but you're the one that's going to need to actually do that. Permit application filings. There are still a few counties where the property owner is the only one who can file the permit. So where we can do it on your behalf, we will, but in some places we're going to need you to do it. So we'll help you fill out the whole form, but you're going to need to be the one that takes that in. And then there's going to be some other responsibilities. So items that we don't include in the base price of the home, because we know some of our homeowners want to do it themselves, or we just don't know exactly what's going to be involved on your land that you're going to choose to do. So things like site clearing, septic systems, construction driveways, things like that, that we need to get done to get the property ready for construction.
Yeah. Some counties be nosy. They want to talk to you in person for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. And or just
bored. Well, I mean, it makes sense. We don't own it, so we shouldn't be the one, you know, you as the owner, the buck stops with you. So you should be the one knowing exactly what's going on. So
you are the voting citizen in the county. Mm-hmm. So
you the taxpayer.
Sometimes you have to leverage that to get something done.
Absolutely. So we're going to run through all the things that we need to do before we can build. So talking about, like I said, the documents, the utilities, site access, and site plan and preparation. So your important documents, they really are going to fall into three basic categories. The first is going to be your deed and your title insurance. We're also going to need your plat and your survey, and we're going to need whatever deed restrictions there are on the property. So your deed, what we're looking for is the piece of paper that really just serves as proof of ownership. So in order for it to be a valid deed, it's going to need a few things. And those are, it's going to actually say, listing out the grantor, who's the person selling it, and the grantee, who is the buyer. And whoever that grantee is needs to match the people who are signing the agreement with us. So it needs to be in your name if you're the one signing the agreement with us. So that's got to be on that deed. It needs to contain a property description. So it's either going to give kind of the, it either be an address, or it'll talk about section this, block that, but there's going to be whatever the legal description is of the property is going to be listed on that deed. It could possibly include the sales price, but that's not necessary for it to be on there. But in a lot of cases, it does tell us what you the amount of money that you purchased the property for. The seller's name, so the person saying, hey, I'm granting this property to you, that signature has to be notarized in order to be valid. And it also must be recorded with the county in order to be valid. So we are looking for that stamp that it was filed with the county and the receipt that was done. So those are the things we're looking for it to be a valid deed.
Important step that is often missed. So
important, yes.
Don't miss that
And
step.
Ideally, you know, also make sure it's filed in the county where property is actually located, because I learned on a transaction that any county will file any piece of paper, whether they're supposed to or not.
They will. They will almost file anything you put in front of them.
Mm-hmm. You give them the $30, they'll put their stamp on it. Title insurance. This is something whenever you are being granted a piece of property, whether it is being given to you by family or you are purchasing it, please make sure that you get a title insurance policy. And what that does is that policy actually guarantees that there's a chain of legal ownership, and it's making sure that that title is clear, and it's protecting you in the future in case that title search missed any type of disputed lien or judgment. It's just protecting you in case anybody comes back and says, oh, wait, the person, this property, you owe me this much money because this work was done. That title insurance policy is going to protect you from those types of things. And this is something you're going to want to request from the title company as soon as an earnest money contract is signed or as soon as you start transferring that title.
Yeah. And what they'll typically give you when you start that transaction, and we do it as well, whenever we start to build with someone and we open title, there's a difference between a title commitment and title insurance. And insurance is exactly, mm-hmm. It's a policy, just like your life insurance policy or car insurance policy or whatever else. Title commitment is simply here's what would need to be satisfied for us to write a policy on this. So, but it does, it tells you that it's especially family land that's being gifted. I know we all think we know our family history. You have been told an edited version of your family history. You have. I just straight up, you don't know the whole thing, and that's okay. What me mom and papa told you is what you need to know, but some other things may have happened that they've been safeguarding you from. It will pop up on title. Don't you worry, it will show up. So always do it. It is relatively inexpensive insurance. And you won't be able to build, you won't be able to get a mortgage on a home if the title is not clear. So very important part of that.
Mm-hmm. We're also going to need your boundary survey. So we're looking for an official survey of the property. It's a drawing of the property. So it's going to have a bunch of different lines on it. There's going to be those solid darker lines that you see on this diagram, and those are actually the boundaries of the property. So that is how much land you own and where that boundary is. The other thing you're going to want to make sure when you're looking at the survey and you're out on your property is that you can find the corner pins. So everywhere that that dark line is hitting a corner, there should be an accompanying pin and a flag marking those boundaries and marking those corners. We're going to want to make sure that we can find those. The other thing that you're going to see on here is a bunch of dotted lines, and all of these are kind of different invisible lines and barriers of your property. And that's showing us the easement. So like I was talking about with the utility companies, they can have an easement which gives them the right to access a certain section of your property whenever they need to maintain lines or fix anything, those types of things. So all of those are going to be noted. You're also going to see some setback lines. So this comes into play with a lot of areas will dictate how close to your property line you can actually build a permanent building structure. So things like a pool, your house, a garage, all of that are going to be, there's a different little boundary that you're able to build those within. They have to be a certain distance off of the road and away from neighboring property just to make sure that everybody has their own space. So it's going to show all of that, those types of things. It is going to list all the dimensions. It's also going to have, you know, the legal description of the property saying that this is what it is. It should also show your flood zone information on it. So you're going to look out for that. And then the most important thing in order for it to be considered of valid surveys, it's going to have that RPLS seal and signature. So it's going to be a registered licensed surveyor who did this. He's going to have a seal on there that he's stamping on it and signing off that this was an actual survey done by a professional.
And yours probably won't have the house drawn on it yet. This happens to be what's called a final survey. So just the blank piece of paper there. So I know we got some questions on this one. Well, we want to finish the
Let's do
and we'll hit the questions. Keep dropping your questions. We're going to answer your questions. I know Denise and Gina and Jason, we're going to answer your questions.
Yeah, just let me get through all the boring paperwork stuff, and then we can answer all the questions.
I get to talk about dirt.
So the last thing that you're going to want to make sure that you have, and this is something I encourage you to get when you're looking to purchase a property, make sure that you get a copy of all of those deed restrictions and covenants that come with it. So if it is in a community that's putting restrictions on it, you want to make sure that you read these before you sign on the dotted line and purchase that property, because by purchasing the property, you're agreeing to all those restrictions. You don't get to fight about it later. You've said, I'm bound by these things. So what is going to be in that is going to really depend upon where the land is located and how strict and master planned of a community it is. But it's going to include some things for us like kind of home design requirements. You're often going to see a minimum square footage. In some locations, you're going to see a maximum height. That usually comes into play if you're dealing with lake views or any type of water view. They're going to designate that your house can be no taller than X feet so that you're not obstructing anybody else's view of the water. There's usually some notes in there about the required materials. So what percent of masonry does it need to be? What do they define as masonry? What types of siding material, what type of roofing material, all of those kinds of things are going to be designated in there in some cases. Garage requirements, you know, whether it's required to be attached, how many bays can you have, what direction do those garage doors have to face, things like that. And then any guidelines through getting your plans approved. So is there a separate committee that you need to submit them to? Are there restricted colors, things like that, and who you're sending all those materials for to, and how much, if there's an application fee or anything like that. There also oftentimes are some things in there about construction requirements. So do we need to put down a separate deposit as the builder? What hours can we work? Is a dumpster required? Is there a maximum weight that we can bring in on the roads? Things like that are going to be designated in these documents. So make sure that you get a copy of those.
All right.
All right.
Pausing. Four questions. We'll answer them all. So I think we created some concerns. We created anxiety. I don't want to create anxiety. That's
we,
didn't,
we don't want to create anxiety. We're here to make everybody
right
feel
now.
Better.
Right now.
We're all right. Let's see.
So Gina is going to contract. I forgot about that.
Yeah. Aristotle got his, he got released. He got released, yes, to construction with Dustin. So that's awesome.
That is a good.
We've got Gina. One of our talent questions on Saturday, when we have the stakeout, can we invite the San Patricio Co-op Electrical?
Yes.
Please. If they will come. Please have them come. Yes.
That is wonderful. If you can get those stars to align and them to come at the same time, that would be chef's kiss of the Build On Your Lot site evaluation experience. That'd be awesome. Our site evaluator would love it.
You will be your stakeout person. Yeah. You'd be his favorite person.
Yep. Yep.
Be love amazing. It. All right. Denise is saying hi from Pearland in pre-planning County stage to build the Canyon D as of today. Yay. In Washington County. Congratulations. Fingers crossed we will start the process in October.
All right. Very cool, Denise.
And then she's asking, do you need the originals or are copies sufficient?
What say you, Dawn?
I believe copies are sufficient.
Yeah, copies are good. In fact, in a lot of cases, we can download them these days off the internet. Like, it's all
a lot of cases we can find it online and download it from the county directly.
It says like not official copy across it real big, because of course they want you to pay. But it is a good idea to have the original somewhere, safety deposit box or a gun safe or something like that. And then if not, if you've lost them completely, it's okay. You still own the property. No one can take it from you. Mm-hmm. And you can go to the county and get what's referred to as certified copies. Sounds strange, but it'll say on it certified copy. In other words, this is as real as it's going to get. So what happens, these things get wet signed, a deed or a warranty with vendor's lien or whatever, sheriff's deed. They get wet signed by the parties that are selling it to you. That signature is notarized, like Dawn said. It's sent to the county for recording. And then the county is going to, before you leave, they're going to take down an address of where do you want the original mailed to whenever we're done. They usually have it for anywhere from 3 to 6 weeks. They'll hold on to it, because they're real busy. And then they're going to mail it off to wherever that is. Sometimes it's a title company. Sometimes it's a law office. Sometimes it's your home office. But once they record it, you could go there anytime you wanted to and get a certified copy. It's legit. It's a done deal. So. Great, great question. But yeah, just copies of them, something printed from online. Those are good enough.
Yeah, she says she has PDFs of all of them. So beautiful. That's perfect. Perfect.
Yeah, that's a great idea. Yeah. Have you?
Yeah, that saves us the bother of scanning it. We love it. It's great. Yep.
You can access from anywhere. It's brilliant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So Jason is asking, so the deed to the property is not acceptable to start building.
Yeah, no. So he asked that when you were bringing up the title policy. No, you're good, Jason. You don't have all that.
You're good. Else. You're good. Yeah.
We're bringing up the in an ideal world, all stars aligned. If you were just starting the process, you haven't bought the property yet, this is what we would recommend you do. Sorry, we've got cables falling down on me over here. Technical difficulties. So, okay. But yeah, no, the deed's all you need. It is absolutely all you need.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Then we've got Carissa watching from Bastrop, preparing to buy property to hopefully build an Angelina soon.
Beautiful. Awesome. Thanks for watching. Ask questions.
Yeah.
Oh, she did.
And Gina says that Talon has all of her documents, her anxiety with B County on anything. Okay.
Yeah, no, it I'll tell you, I get it. That is kind of funny, but if I had to pick a county to have a problem with, it'd be they're pretty simple. And I don't mean they're simple people. I mean, it's a simple office to deal with compared to some others. I'm not saying they don't have their imperfections.
There's not a lot of bureaucracy in B County.
Yeah. They're not a whole lot of layers of management at B County. And the ones that are have probably been there a very, very long time. So it's probably not that hard to get. I find I'm a very Columbo-ish for that old TV show, or very hat in hand kind of approach to start with, very humble. You're new to town. You know, and you're just looking for help. You just need a little help. People like to help other people. They feel fulfilled. So if they can feel like they help you, you're going to get a lot more done. You go in guns blazing as a new kid in town, might have a problem. You're going to be in good shape, Gina. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Gina's also saying that she would also pick up the water welder or an electric person if she has to for the stakeout. Yep. You will definitely be your land prep specialist's favorite person.
That's funny.
That's awesome. Then we have Carissa asking, does the homeowner pay out of pocket for utility meters and applications?
Great question, Carissa. So if you're looking at the pricing that Dawn has on our website, so those prices would not include any kind of water tap, utility meter, any of that. Now, what I will say is if we're building a home in a city, we do typically put allowances in for those things. But it is always smart to ask, because like Dawn said earlier, there are some places that they won't let us do it, as they want whoever owns the land, whoever is on the deed or entitled to the property, that's who they want making the application. Now, a lot of them, they'll let you give permission to us to do it on your behalf. And we kind of walk you through that as we go, and it really kind of depends. The reason we don't include it, because we never know what the house, what the land already has or what it needs. You know, we don't know, broadly speaking, is it going to be on a septic system? Is it going to have city sewer? Is it going to need a water well, or does it have some kind of community water? Does it have gas available, or are you going to have a propane tank, or are you going to be all electric? Is there a transformer at or near the property? So rather than put all the pricing in for all of those things, making the houses really unaffordable if we included all those things, because they're redundant. You don't need all of them. We left it out, and then we deal with it case by case. Great question.
All right. And then she's also asking, what type of construction driveway does the homeowner need to provide?
Oh, this is so beautiful. Thank you, Carissa. We are going to deal with it directly here in just a little bit, but basically some type of all-weather access is what we refer to. In other words, that we can still get on and off the property when and after it rains. So usually that means some type of crushed rock, crushed limestone, crushed concrete material, usually, you know, at least 12 feet wide, and that's all we need. And sometimes you will need a culvert, which we'll also talk about, to cross the ditch to get over. We'll give specific examples and have pictures and everything. Great question.
Okay. Perfect. And we've got Eric saying greetings from Beaumont. Hey, Eric.
Welcome, Eric. How are you doing?
And then we have Julie asking if Tilson builds barndominiums.
All right. Great question. We get this question a lot. I know barndominiums are a rage, particularly on all the social medias. And the answer is it's a little complicated. So can we build you a home, a single family home that looks like a barndominium? Yes. What we have found, a customer brought a plan in the other day. I happened to be at the office after they had left. It was a barndominium plan that they brought in that had no garage whatsoever. It was just no place for cars, which is kind of like, it's full circle. Because the whole point of the barndominium is it's basically a metal building or shop that you build a little bit of living quarters in. And so it's funny because it's kind of morphed into this. It's really just a look. So Julie, first I'd say, what kind of look are you going for? The reason barndominiums get complicated is because the financing can get complicated. So on a cash deal, we'd have a lot better, a lot more flexibility on what we could do. On a loan or a mortgage deal, they can't all be financed in various counties. I know that's going to sound very bizarre, but there's a lot of lenders that don't want to touch them. They get kind of mixed up in their loan committees of, is it a single family residence? Is it a metal building? Is it a shop? You know, so it does get a little bit sticky, and we have found a number of customers who have come to us after starting down the road with a barndominium company, and they can't get financed. And ironically, the more rural it gets, the harder they are to finance, which I know is paradoxical because, but that's, it has nothing to do with the structure. It has everything to do with the lending practices and the behaviors and the compliance on the lending side for the type of loan program that it is. So ask those questions. If you're after a look, a straight flat across the front with a porch going across the front of that, that's got a double bay garage door.
Yeah. You're looking for a house that looks like a barn. Yes,
we can do that. Yeah, we can do that.
No factor. If you're looking for the
questions about the financing.
Yeah. Yeah. If you're looking for like the technical barn dominium, which is a steel building with a single family residence inside of it, that you're basically building the house kind of twice. That's where it gets a little,
it can get very sticky on the financing.
So yeah. Depends on your definition. All right.
Let's talk utilities. Folks, keep dropping your questions into the chat. We'll answer every one of them. Now we're going to talk about how we're going to get this thing built and make sure you have running water and make sure you take showers as you should, and how we're going to heat the stuff. So let's talk power. And this varies wildly across the state of Texas. Texas is a deregulated state when it comes to power providers. There is still the Public Utilities Commission, and they give some guidelines, and that you can't, you know, treat people wrong or gouge people for pricing. But broadly speaking, there's not, the state doesn't tell you what you have to do. Most of our customers are building in a, what they call a co-op or a cooperative. So if in the past you've gotten to kind of choose your provider, you know, your Green Mountain Energy or your TXU or your Reliant or NRG or whatever, that kind of goes away if you're building out in the country. It's okay. They're very competitive rates, and it's really nice. You're actually part owner. You get a dividend check at the end of the year. It's kind of cool. So, but we've got to first determine who's providing it. Meet a representative out there. So like Gina was planning earlier, this is going to be so easy for Gina, because I can tell she's a planner and she's going to have the San Patricio Electric Co-op to be out there with our site evaluator, which is fantastic. That way nobody's saying, well, they said this and I saw that. But they're going to help lay out. We got a couple of examples here I'm going to run through. So this is on the far left of your screen here. You got just overhead power. So way in the background, maybe hard to see, there's a transformer on a pole. So what's coming across these power poles is very high voltage, right? And the transformer transforms that down, the amperage down to what a house or barn would need. And so then the power company came and set these poles. Looks like they set three poles from the transformer. And then what we've set up here, we had our temporary pole set. We left a meter loop up here that they could hook into. The power company showed up, our temporary pole passed inspection. They plugged the meter in, and then this is what we will work off of. This will not be here permanently. This is just for us to work off of. And then later this would come down overhead to where the house will be with a weatherhead. The next two examples are two different examples of underground power. So this one on the middle left is Perdinales Electric Co-op. So it's out in the Texas Hill Country. The one next to it is Mid-South Synergy or Mid-South Co-op, which is kind of in the Bryan College Station, Richards, Navasota area, and beyond into Montgomery County. They're getting pretty big these days. So it's showing that the power, so in this particular case on the Mid-South one, the transformer, you can't see it, it's actually up on the pole, and then it comes down through this conduit into this pedestal, the meter. So the co-op installs the pedestal, the meter, and everything. It's got little outlets to work off on both sides, so in this case we don't need a temporary pole. And then this one here, very, very similar, but Perdinales and some of the other ones in the Hill Country require a rack system to be built. So it looks like a commercial electrical service, but this is actually for a residence. So in the Hill Country, particularly Perdinales Electric Co-op, this is very common. And this is a little bit more expensive process. You have to have an electrician build this. We can put you onto them. We can do it. And then once it's built and inspected and trench dug and all that kind of stuff, the co-op comes out and inspects it. As long as it passes inspection, they'll put the meter in. And you can see there's a little outlet right here. We would work off of that. So again, no T-pole needed. And then lastly, this is what's referred to as a member-owned pole. So this is actually another Hill Country style setup. So it is overhead power, comes to a weatherhead here. The member would have bought this pole. This will be the permanent pole here. The meter will sit here. the breaker box may sit and stay here, or sometimes it gets put over onto the house. That's kind of the customer preference, sometimes the co-op preference. But in all these cases, obviously there's going to be a breaker panel in the house somewhere, either on the outside of the house or inside the house. And that's where you control all your breakers like normal. But these are just different applications. Again, it's very, very broad across the state as to what will be required. Don't worry, we will walk you through it. We've encountered all kinds. So That's power. Very important. Hard to build a house without power. Next, you need water of some sort. We need water of some sort for construction too. So it doesn't have to be there like the day that we set forms or even do concrete, but we need it pretty shortly after that. If it is there, great. That's even better. But So the bottom example is a typical water meter. So this means there's some type of community water, either a city water or, like I said, community water. It doesn't mean that you're in a city, but sometimes like a company will go in and put a gigantic well in and then sell water taps to a development, to an area. Very, very common. They usually have different size meters that they can sell you, like a minimum is typically 5/8 inch up to 3/4, in some cases a 1 inch meter. And then the top example is a water well. So ironically, this part here is just the pressure tank. Here's your trivia for the day. This is not the well. The well's actually this black part right here that goes down into the ground. So this well goes down a couple hundred feet into the ground, probably. It's concrete encased. And then what comes up goes through here. And then there's usually a little hose bib here. It goes into the pressure tank. All the pressure tank does is it keeps pressure on to where this runs from here to the house or whatever distribution point. So think of it as like a miniature version of the water tower you see in a country town. That's all the water tower is. It's just a big old pressure tank. And it's usually when you see them, they're up on a high hill. They don't have to be here, but in a city, they usually do that way. Everybody keeps pressure. When everybody turns their water on between 6 and 7 a.m. in the morning, the whole city doesn't go with water pressure. So now, what do we do with the water after we're done using it? That's the next thing. So septic, this will have to be decided again before we can start construction. All counties in Texas require septic permitting of some sort. So are we going to be sewer, which is usually only if you're actually in a city. So it's pretty rare that our customers are doing that. Only about 8 or 9% of our customers are going to be on an actual sewer system. Or are you going to be on a septic system, which is what 91-92% of our customers are doing. So it's really cool these days that this is an example of an aerobic septic system, a spray application. So you'll see the acronym OSSF, which is on-site sewage facility. So it's truly a miniaturized sewage plant. This hunk of concrete has three chambers in it. So there's like a little wall here and a little wall here. So you got the solids tank where everything goes into. It's coming from the house, which in this picture is right here. So the house is sitting somewhere right over here. The sewer pipe comes out, goes into here, and then it goes into a aerobic treatment tank where it's truly treated. There's an aerator. That's what this thing is. So a bubble machine to allow the bacteria to continue to grow. And then a holding tank. And this holding tank has a float valve in it. When that water level gets up to a certain point, it tells the motor, hey, kick on, and then it sprays that treated wastewater onto a pre-designated field somewhere out away from the house. And there's all kinds of parameters where it can't be close to property line or water well or neighbor or house or things like that. So there's conventional septic systems, there's aerobic septic systems. Then within the aerobic septic system, there's spray or surface application, which is what this is. There's also a drip application or subsurface application, which is used. We usually only see those used on a lake. Like if you're within 1,000 feet of a body of water and you have to have a septic system, you're probably going to get a drip aerobic system. And again, We walk you through all this. Typically all that requires a design. So a registered sanitarian or professional engineer will do a design. We'll put you in contact with them, or we'll do it. We offer these things. And then we take that design to the county, make an application, and then they make sure that it meets all the parameters that TCEQ sets out, Texas Commission on Environmental Quality. And then they give back a septic permit that says, okay, you're good to go. You don't necessarily put the septic in right away. We typically ask that it gets installed after the brick or stone, or we're finished with the outside of the house, basically, so that our trucks aren't running over it to damage it. And then lastly on the utilities is Are you going to have gas? So your options are going to be, your home can be totally electric, 100% electric, which actually most of our model homes are. In fact, almost all, I think maybe all of our model homes are. They're all total electric. Or if you want to have gas, your options are either natural gas, if it's available where you're building, or if it's not available, you will need to have some type of a propane tank. So we have an above ground application here. They also make them whether you can bury them. In some places, they require that you bury them, some subdivisions. Mm-hmm. So it can be done either way. You can buy the tank. You can rent the tank. You can work that out with the LP provider. We just need to know up front what type of fuel you'll be using, if you'll be using fuel at all. Are you going to be using natural gas or propane? Because the orifices on the all the appliances are different. So the same appliances will work, but the orifices have to be changed out. So that's your furnaces, water heaters, actual appliances, or your stove, that kind of stuff. Now, how we get into this thing? Side access. Where's Carissa? Carissa, here's our pictures. I promised you. So this is a primo example. Okay, not all of them look like this. I'm not going to lie to you. but this customer went all out. So this is why we do pictures of it. This would be awesome. This is like Tilson Construction Department heaven. It doesn't have to be this big, but it's helpful if it is. But whoever did this did a great job, you know, great turning radiuses, because you're talking big trucks coming in. It's not a pickup truck, although that one is, but think concrete trucks, dump trucks, 18 wheelers to drop off lumber packages. But minimum will be 12 feet wide, of typically 4-inch thick of some type of crushed rock, crushed limestone, crushed concrete material. And you'll see that there's actually a stabilized base. So this is a culvert. Culvert's simply a fancy word for a pipe in the ground. So you got ditches that allow the water to run when it's raining. So the road kind of crowns in the middle. The main, let's say you're on, you know, County Road 248 or FM 1488, that road crowns so that when it rains, water runs off of it. Those runs into a ditch. And this is a way to cross that ditch and still allow water to go through. Typically the county, the size that will be determined by the county precinct. And in a lot of cases, they'll set it for you. Not all cases, but in a lot of cases, they'll actually set it for you. You do want this professionally installed by someone because it's really important that it match the grade of the street. Otherwise, it becomes a dam. If it slopes the opposite way that the road is flowing, that could create a problem. So, and in some cases, it does have to be permitted. Site planning. So we're going to meet you out there on the property. Obviously, we're going to help you stake the home on your property, ask you some feedback. You know, is this the direction you thought your front door would be facing? Hey, is this the view from your master bedroom that you were envisioning? Is this the view from the porch that you wanted? We help you with all that kind of stuff out. We draw like a little site plan showing where trees are, where electrical is coming in. We help you with all this. You know, hey, look, it's looking like based on your neighbor, you know, their power's coming here. Yours will likely be here. Septic system's going to be over here because they have a water well here. We help you with all of that stuff. And then any necessary clearing, groundwork, culverts, we can get bids on all those things and do it for you, or you can have it done. We just ask that you keep us in the loop because sometimes we can do it a whole lot faster. So should we pause for questions before I go into a lot more of these?
Yeah.
That's a great idea. I'm glad you had that, Dawn.
That's an excellent idea. Let's do that. All right. We've got Steven saying, you both are great. Oh, you're so sweet. See, he knows the key to our heart. He knows how to get his comments shown. I'm in New Ulm in Colorado County in the builder selection phase. My property has an existing well and septic system. I plan on demolishing the existing house and building about 100 yards away. Who determines if I can use the existing well and septic system? Both would be downstream from the new house.
All right. So on the water well, you're going to have no problem. I mean, 100 yards is kind of a long way, but it's not impossible. I would recommend going with at least 2-inch diameter water line. So mine's 330 feet from my house. So 100 yards is doable. Mine does sit uphill from it, but once the pressure is established, you should be good. But a 2-inch minimum water line running from your water well to the home is what I would recommend. That won't be an issue. So the septic, the downstream from the new house. So the county is going to determine ultimately if you can use that or not. So Colorado County, I think you said New Ulm, right? Yeah. Colorado County would be the, so what you need to get done. And you can do it, you know, you're still in the builder selection phase. It's a little early to have it done because you probably don't know exactly what plan you're doing, but when the time comes and you've chosen your builder, and you get at least a floor plan or the actual plan, That's going to have to be given to a registered sanitarian or PE. I would highly recommend using one of the ones. So Colorado County will have a list of recommended registered sanitarians. Start there because they probably like talking to those people if they're on their list. Mm-hmm. I always find it funny because you get the list from them. You tell us like a Xerox of a Xerox of a Xerox. It's got like name scratched out. Like, ooh, that's not good.
Ooh, what did he do?
Either they passed away or they did something bad. So anyway, I would invite, hey, do you guys have a list of registered sanitarians y'all recommend to have come take a look at my septic system, see if I can still use this thing? The chances, I mean, I don't know what size the home is that you're tearing down, but you know, the odds may not be great they let you use it. I'm not saying that you can't. They may ask you to add field line or add a tank or something like that. You know, in other words, you may have a hybrid going on. Like, okay, you can, 100 yards is a long way for a septic. And the reason I say that is you have to have enough fall, which I see they're downstream, but you don't want too much fall. So I know that sounds strange, but picture, you know, to the degree that you're comfortable, solids moving through the septic tank, tissue paper. Okay. If it's too steep, the water will just run and it won't carry the tissue paper. It won't
carry the stuff with it.
Exactly. Yeah. So you can have some, and anyway, that's what a registered sanitarian will figure out. You don't have to do all those calculations. There are calculations that TCEQ gives them. There's parameters, there's guidelines. This is something we have to figure out, but don't be shocked if the county comes back and either says, no, you need to put a new one in, or yeah, you can use it, but we want you to add an additional tank. Again, I don't know what was there before. If it was a, you know, 3-bedroom, 2-bath trailer, and you're putting in a 4-bedroom, 3-bath, you know, brick home, they believe it or not, it's actually done by bedrooms. So they mm-hmm. don't care if it's a 5-bedroom, 1-bath house or a 5-bedroom, 3-bath house. They base it on how many people could be using this thing at one time. That's going to be determined on bedrooms. So, and it's not even a matter of what you and your wife are doing, right? So they're like, hey, yeah, that's fine. It's just the two of you. You could sell it next year to a family of 12 and they could be using it. So
right.
they're going to base all of their calculations on the new home, how many bedrooms it has, how many gallons per day that would use based on their parameters, and how many gallons per day that existing septic system can handle. So they'll calculate all that, submit that to the county, and that's how it's determined. 100 yards is a long way for a septic system. Not impossible. What might have to happen is potentially a grinder pump. So right outside the house, basically, it's exactly that. It grinds up the solids, and then it sends them, physically pumps it down further, so you don't have to worry about the fall anymore. So you got options, though, Stephen. You got options. We can walk you through it. We've done it. We've done it all the ways I just mentioned. We've done it.
All right. We have Steve who's saying hello from Wilson County, coming down the stretch on our custom Angelina B. Appliances going in this week. I'm very happy with every aspect of this experience so far. Glad I found Tilson. Oh, thank you so much.
Same for the people in the back, Steve. You hear that, Steven? That's Steve telling you that.
We got Jason asking, if the culvert is on an FM road, does it have to be permitted by TxDOT?
Old stars for Jason McDaniel. Yes, sir. If it is on a farm to market road, any kind of state maintained right of way, the culvert must be permitted by the Texas Department of Transportation. There's usually a local office. If not in the town where you are, for sure the county seat of where you are. But mostly it's in one of the bigger even Navasota, Texas has a TxDOT office. And 60% of the time they're very pleasant to work with. So not the Navasota ones, I'm talking about in general.
All right. Carissa's asking, she says, a sales consultant we met with priced us with an aerobic septic. Is that required in Bastrop County or by Tilson, or can we pursue anaerobic septic?
Okay, so yeah, she's asking about there's two types, right? There's conventional, which is anaerobic, and there's aerobic. And so it's not impossible in Bastrop, but it usually requires a lot of land, or it sometimes will require having, I mean, I don't know how much sand you have. The kicker with aerobic conventional septic systems is the state its parameters require a whole lot of sand. Just most places don't have the amount of sand that's required for the distance there or amount of field line that you need without giving up you know, you start getting too close to neighbors or start getting too close to, and that's why a big piece of property really helps. 10, 15, 20 acres, it's usually not a big issue there, but on an acre and a half, 2 acres, something like that, by the time you have the house and your neighbor's house, your neighbor's water well, or your water well, it starts, all those things have buffer zones around them that you can't have septic system, field line stuff within. And so you start to get pretty limited on space. So it's not impossible. We would have no problem asking. We do conventional systems as well. I don't know for sure if Bastrop will allow them or not, but they are still legal in the state of Texas and they work fine. Like, as long as the earth is spinning and there's gravity, they work fine. But so if those things stop happening, the septic's the least of your worries. So it doesn't matter anyway.
All right. We've got Eric asking, sanitarians or sanitariums? I may need a registered sanitarium after all of this.
Yes.
It's going to be okay, Eric. It's going to be okay.
The technical question, the answer is the first. But yes, sanitarium is, they should be probably more of those things floating around, Eric, between you and me. There used to be a lot more. We didn't have crazy people running around.
All right. Steven says, thank you for all the help on his system.
There you go.
We got Donna asking, is stained concrete usually cheaper than LVP?
So it's pretty close to being the same. I was trying to pull it up. I was doing that, but so let's see, vinyl plank. I mean, level one vinyl plank, you're starting around 550 square foot, and then, stained concrete 7. So, I mean, it's very close. It's the level one LVP is a little less, but I'll be honest, you're probably going to be happier with a level two or level three. And at that point, mm-hmm. yes, it's pretty equal to being the same price.
Okay. All right. Denise is asking, do you know if a separate line to septic can be added from a barn?
I do. Yes. But you need to have that in the design up front. So whenever your septic person's designing it, they need to know, like, hey, I plan on having a little bathroom in my barn over here, and I want that stubbed out to run to, because there are some, obviously, same thing with the fall, all that needs, and they need to know, you know, they're not too terribly worried about the gallons per day, but the fall is a significant part of that calculation. You want to make sure that the wastewater from whatever you got in there is has the proper fall to get to that septic system. And distance could be an issue. I don't know how close it's going to be. So,
okay. Phyllis is asking, does the construction driveway run up to where you anticipate your garage to be located? What is the process? We have included an allowance for this.
Yeah, so we do require that the construction drive be no less than 25 feet from the house. Closer the better. But minimum is 25. It has to end or begin, depends on where you're walking from, 25 feet from the home. And yeah, where the garage is going to go in is a great spot. And that is the process. So, the process would be, you meet our site evaluation team out there, one of our land preparation specialists. We stake the home out. We're going to flag it. You'll know where the garage is going to be. You kind of know they'll usually flag where your driveway is going to be. And then either like you said, we've got an allowance included, so we can start getting bids at that point, because we'll have the distance. And if not, we will give you the distance and say, hey, you need you know, 113 feet of construction drive. That'll get you within, you know, 15, 25 feet of the job site and so when you're getting your bids, go tell them this. Here's a flag from this flag to this flag, 12 feet wide minimum. And going back to Jason's point on the FM, the state TxDOT stuff, they actually have parameters on those radiuses that I was showing you, which is probably why that one looked like that, because it probably is on a farther market road. But larger radiuses, sloped culvert ends, they have kill zones, all this kind of stuff that they're a little more expensive to do it on a state highway, but it doesn't, I mean, that's where your property is, where your property is, doesn't matter. But just know that if you are on a state right of way, you'll probably pay a little bit more for your culvert installation, because the state of Texas requires some other, of course, ancillary things, because they're protecting us.
Okay. All right. We've got Charlie who's asking, can we have a sub panel and sewer line ran to a location behind our house for a future shop guest house down the line?
So sub panel is a great idea. We can put a sub panel on the back of the house if you want to, or at least make a knockout for one if you want to, because I don't know how far along you're doing it, Charlie, but the sewer line's a little bit different animal. We wouldn't run the sewer line. We would just want to, again, when we're designing that septic, you don't want to run the sewer from your guest house or shop into your home and then go out. You'd want to run it just directly into the septic system. So what I'm envisioning is you have your house, you have a septic somewhere behind there to the side of it, and then you have a shop or guest house behind that. They would meet, their sewer lines would meet at that septic system that's between the two of them. So you would just, again, we'd want to be sure when we're designing the septic system that we knew you were going to, what you were putting, is it a half bath? Is it a full bath? You know, what do we need to account for in the, when the registered sanitarian is, I'll be more articulate for our man, Eric, he's right. I should do better. How many gallons per day could be flowing through that system? You want to be sure it can handle the maximum number of gallons per day when it's raining and the soil is wet. Like you want to, the hardest conditions that you want to be sure it'll still perform. You don't want 14 people there at Christmas and the septic system's like, I'm kind of done. That's a bad day. There's a Griswold Christmas about that with Cousin Eddie in a line I can't say.
All right. Gina says her property is off Farm to Market on a private road. Thank goodness I had the culvert permitted with TxDOT. FYI, the culvert was not even on my property. I have a right of way.
Oh, yeah, that can happen. Sure enough.
TxDOT stated they would have paid for the culvert, but I had to because it was a private road.
Oh, isn't it easy to say that, Gina? They're like, oh, we would totally have paid for that. We totally would have paid that.
Gosh.
And by the way, what TxDOT paying for, you're paying for. It's our tax dollars, for goodness sake.
They just raise your taxes later.
You're telling me they're paying for anything is laughable. I'm paying for it.
Yeah.
You're not paying for anything. It's like saying
it's included. It's included.
You're taking it. You're taking this money. Paying you.
Jason's reporting it's around $4,200 for a 30-foot culvert installed along the Farm to Market Road where he is. That's just one quote. Does that sound right?
It does. It actually sounds pretty inexpensive, honestly. And 30 foot is big. That's I think the maximum width for a residence for non-commercial is like 26 feet of the driveway width. So that would need like a 30 foot culvert. So yeah, that's a pretty competitive price, honestly.
Yeah. And he says TxDOT told him that they haven't installed culvert since the early 90s. So
probably true.
And then Donna says, sorry, one more question. How much cleared space do you need around the foundation if you're building around trees?
Good question. Okay. So there's debate about this. It varies around the state. Like what is really required or what do we like? Okay. So required, I'd say at least 10 feet. That's getting pretty tight. 20 is better, but I get it. You know, if you've got a 30-year-old oak tree 12 feet away, we're not going to ask you to cut that down. The engineer might require that we put in some hard points on that side. So that's something to consider, but look, there's a reason you're moving out into the country. We get that. But minimum 10 feet all the way around minimum. And also know that a tree, particularly in drought times, can suck up, I mean, thousands of gallons of water. And so it's something to consider on foundation maintenance long term, that if you have a bunch of trees on one side and not a lot on the other, you're going to have to manage that. You have to water a lot on the side that has the trees, because the trees are going to suck that water up and it could make that house fall. So something to consider. Trees are beautiful. I'm all for it. Some trees are beautiful. Some trees are not very pretty, but most trees are beautiful.
Okay. Yep. Peter asking, do you typically have the construction drive built with the land clearing? Is the stakeout done before or after land clearing?
All right. Great question. So I can skip some slides because this is answering questions. It's about 50-50, Peter, honestly. So in an ideal world for us, but it's not about us, it's about the customer. Yeah, it's all done at one time and the construction drive's in, but we get it. You may not know exactly how you want your driveway to be. And so we do have to have, at least the property must be minimum underbrushed, which underbrush just means all the big trees are still there, even the stuff that's sitting inside the footprint of the home that's going to ultimately go. But all of that, the yaupon and the cedars and all the junk are gone, so that we can at least walk it with you and our lasers can pick up a signal. Lasers are powerful, but they don't go through trees or brush. So in order for us to get a good gauge of the out of level and site, you know, how we're going to mitigate drainage, all that kind of stuff, it does need to be, and even just to walk it with you and pull tapes, it needs to be at least underbrushed. So what we've seen a lot of cases is maybe we just get it underbrushed and then we come in and do the stakeout with you, put the stakes there and say, everything inside of here must go. And then here's where the construction drive is going to go. All those trees go. And then someone could come in at one time and clear all that and put the construction drive in altogether. But it doesn't have to be that way. It can be cleared and then come back. They come back and do the construction drive. It's not a big deal. We see it done 50-50.
All right. We got Janine saying, hey, Tilson Cousins from Austin, working with Sarah in Georgetown, and I recently stepped up to the Poliduro from the San Jacinto.
Congratulations.
I'm considering panel fronts for the fridge and dishwasher. What are the pros and cons?
Yeah. Well, I'll let Dawn answer this. What do you think about?
Pros, they're pretty. Cons, they're expensive.
Yeah. And could go out of style. That'd be the...
Yeah.
My deal would be, what do you do when you're tired of them? But hey, I bought a white fridge that has gold handles on it. So it's not going to be in style forever. And I get that.
Yeah. But yeah, it's beautiful. It's a beautiful look if that's what you're going for. But it is definitely more expensive than not having it. And really, that's kind of it.
Yeah, the dishwasher especially, that was one, because those are probably tougher to change later. I just now saw that it was a dishwasher too. I mean, they're pretty. I like it.
Yeah. We got Tim saying, question about easements. If you own two lots side by side, do we still have to have the easement on each side of the property lines?
Okay. Well, Tim, it would depend on if they're there already. So we'll go back to our example of the survey. Don, if you want to pull it up. So what Tim's saying, if I understand it right, he's got the lot here. Pretend the house is not here. He also has the lot next door. Okay. And his house, and what I'm wondering is, are you going to set the house straddling across the two? It's possible to do. But in most cases, to do that, if they are already platted, if they are platted lots, most counties are for sure a city, but most counties are going to require that those lots be replatted and that, you combine them as one lot. If there are easements there, which they may be, if it's a platted, again, if it's a platted subdivision in the county, those easements would have been there. If there are easements at all, if there's not easements, it doesn't matter, but building lines, if there's building lines there, there's a process you go through to get those removed. If there are easements there, same thing. If there's nothing under the easements, you can have those easements, what's referred to as abandoned. So you would have to get the power company or water company, whoever, you go to their office and say, hey, can you verify that nothing here? Okay, we verified it. We drove out there. Cool. We are comfortable. And they'll actually have to sign a document saying, hey, we no longer have an easement there, because they won't let you build a permanent structure, like Don said earlier, on top of an easement. It's still your property. You'll still pay taxes on it. You can grow a garden on it. You can run and play and fetch ball and all that, but you can't build permanent structure, house, pool, outbuilding, all that kind of stuff. So that's a question. I'd like to take a look at the survey if you've got it, or whoever your consultant is, take a look at the survey. We could tell you from that and talking to the county of whether or not you would need to actually have it replatted. If it's in a city, I can just about guarantee you it's going to have to be replatted.
Okay.
Which is not a big deal. I'm not trying to scare anybody, but there's a process. That's all.
Right. Just stuff to be aware of. Mm-hmm. All right. Then we've got Steven sharing that he paid $700 each for his two, and he corrected it below 15-inch by 24-foot culverts from McCoy's, and the county installed them.
Shout out to McCoy's Building Supply. Highly recommend getting it from them. And yeah,
Gina says she paid $5,600 for hers. So
on the state, yeah.
Lots of variation. Yeah,
I would say somewhere between $4,000 and $6,000 on a state right of way. They won't all cost that, but the state, again, they have these fancy concrete sloped ends that they want, and they have bigger radiuses. There's more material. They want stabilized sand on top of the culvert before you can put the rock on top of it. So it's okay. It's all part of the process.
It's all good.
The good news is they'll mow it. They'll plant bluebonnets. Maybe. Who knows? With your tax dollars. All right. So site plan.
It's included in your taxes.
Oh, totally. Yes. Thanks to Lady Bird Johnson. All right. We've included this one. We don't do this on every single home. This happens to be one that the subdivision required a scaled CAD drawn site plan. And so we did it so we could show you all the different, so you see the building lines are on here. Usually Don does this part. Sorry, I'm talking. Anyway, you got your building lines, you got your setback lines. It's showing where the house is going to be. It's showing where the proposed driveway, the permanent driveway is going to go. It is showing the culvert dimensions. The street name is Merlot. There's actually in Vintage Oaks there, New Braunfels. Mm-hmm. Showing you building lines. Again, it's just we're proving to the subdivision that we're not encroaching on any of their setbacks, on any of their building lines, any neighbor's properties, any property lines. We're calling out all the things they want called out. So like water meter is here and electrical is here. Septic, proposed spray field for your septic system is going to be here. Proposed underground for the electrical is here. So anyway, not all of them require this level of detail, but it's just showing you that it can be done. So mm-hmm. Then the next thing that happens is we go clear the thing, which we've talked about ad nauseum so far. So yeah, clear it. Obviously, it looks a little bit gnarly when this is going on because everything inside the footprint of the home and under your driveway, you need to get the roots and all out. Everything has to come out. So don't let somebody just come in and cut the timber and say, oh, we'll do it for free, you know, and they leave the stumps. That's where the real work is. That's what the machine is for. So this is a, 300 series excavator with a hydraulic thumb on it. It can literally pick those things up. And you can either haul them off, or in some cases, they can be burned on site. That will dictate the ultimate price. Obviously, if they have to be hauled off, that costs more money. If they can be burned on site safely and it's allowed, then we try to encourage the land clearing folks to do that if it's possible. It's not always possible. We get that. So. Then once all that organic material is off, then we can start bringing in dirt work. We can get any kind of construction drives done, drainage work done. I see there's some silt fencing that went up here. That's probably required by that county. And then now that all that stuff has been done, we can actually build a house. So, which mm-hmm. is the point of this whole presentation, is showing you that there's a lot that goes into build on your lot that you weren't really privy to if you've only ever done a subdivision build. So anyway,
yep.
Let's answer more questions. Y'all keep them coming.
Yeah. So we have Tim who was talking about the two lots side by side that they are platted in Hamilton County. So I'll follow up with them. Hope to close on the second lot today. Thanks for your help as always.
Oh yeah, no problem. And yeah, Hamilton County is pretty easy to deal with. Actually very easy to deal with. And you will not regret having both lots. Okay. Even if it is a little bit of a process to go through to get any kind of easements abandoned or replatted or whatever, it's nice pushing your neighbors further away. Good to have neighbors, but boundaries matter. Distance.
All right, we've got Eric saying, and speaking with two very trusted concrete contractors in my area, I was advised that post-tension slab designs do not work in our area with the gumbo clay. Would the geotech and engineer know to add steel reinforcements, piers under beams for our specific area?
They will, yeah. So they're going to do a geotechnical investigation. We do on every single house. Mm-hmm. I'll flat out disagree respectfully with them that post tension is not good for gumbo clay, which is not a technical term, by the way. So it makes me, anyway, not disputing their reputation. Just, I know we've built a whole bunch of houses in the last 92 years, including in the Jefferson County, Beaumont, Orange, the Golden Triangle, Port Arthur, all the way up to, everything around there. Okay. We've been building, Lumberton and all of those areas. And it's, there is no reason post-tension won't work. There is still rebar used in a lot of areas of post-tension foundations, particularly corners. You'll see it call for 5/8 rebar to reinforce some corners. And yes, if there are any hard points or something like that needed that the engineer feels like, hey, due to the plasticity index of this soil, and I would love to see if a concrete company has actually done a geotechnical investigation of any of these or if they just are delivering concrete. But we will have a geotech and we have to stand behind it, as does the engineer for 10 years. Concrete companies aren't on the hook for squat when it comes to your foundation. So I would highly recommend we take the advice of the people who are actually on the hook for mm-hmm. the warranty by law and do what they say to do. And that's all I have to say about that. We're going to get it done right, Eric. I promise you.
Yeah.
All right, folks. Last call for questions. We do have a couple of things we want to announce. But yeah, if you got questions, drop them into the chat. We want to hear from you. We will answer them. Hopefully, we got your questions answered today. But Don, we got a special behind the scenes this weekend. What's going on?
We do. We have our Behind the Sheetrock event in Angleton. So we are building two new models down there, the Arlington and the Refurio. And this weekend on Saturday, we are going to be having the regional construction manager down there actually talking, showing you everything behind the sheetrock. So one of the homes is going to be just the mechanicals are done. And the other one, it's going to have the insulation in. So you can see both phases of construction and really kind of get the appreciation for where the quality of your home truly is, which is behind the sheetrock before we start covering it up and putting all the pretty stuff in place. So it's a great opportunity to come and take a look. And both of these houses are in a windstorm requirement area. So you can actually see all the extra stuff that's done for that. And so it was very different from what I've seen in all of the other houses. So highly recommend going and checking that out.
Yeah.
Lots of metal. Happening in that house. So yeah, it's very excited about that,
show that off. It'll be cool.
Mm-hmm. So that'll be fun. And then if you're too far from Angleton, you can't make it to that one, we also have some different seminars happening throughout the state this weekend as well. So we've got San Marcos is having one, Georgetown is having one, and there's also one in Huntsville.
Very cool. So yeah, we'd love to see you guys out there. Get a lot of questions answered. We have a construction team that will be walking you through there. And again, the seminar, part of the biggest appeal for me, if I were you, of these events is you get to mix up with like-minded people that are doing the same things, ask a lot of questions. They're on the same journey. We find they have a lot of the same interests. Our customer, we have a type. It's a great type. And so it's really cool to see them kind of interact and ask questions. And so don't ever be afraid to ask questions or go to these events. They're great, great places to mix it up with other people that are, again, doing the same thing you're doing. And they might think of something you didn't think of. It's possible.
Mm-hmm. Give you some advice on culverts, tell you where to get them.
That's right.
Just great to hang out with everybody. So hopefully you guys can make it out.
Yeah. We got Jason and Phyllis that popped in questions while we were.
Oh, okay. Jason is asking... I trust you. Sorry, I didn't scroll down. Jason's asking, do we ever get to meet you guys at any events? We pop up every once in a while. So we're frequently popping around the state. So you might actually see us in the offices, like Eric was saying. Eric, I think you're going to Angleton this weekend.
That is the plan. We're trying to move one other arrangement around to try and make it down there. But yeah, I think I'm going to be down there. I may have a fifth generation in tow. We'll see.
Very nice. Very nice. So yeah, you guys you'll see us. We'll usually tell you when we're going to be somewhere. But yeah, you also could run into us throughout the state because we're in the design centers pretty frequently.
I was going to say it's impossible, Jason. We're actually artificial intelligence. We're not even real. We're like the Pepsi guys in the 80s.
We're hired actors. That's why we're so good at this.
They know better than that. I got a face for radio, son. That is not the case here. Maybe for you, but not this guy.
Yeah, you'll see us around. And then we've got Phyllis asking, do you happen to know where the Lone Star model home is in the process?
Yeah, it's in Republic Grand Ranch. I'm just kidding. So it is, it's getting very close.
It's pretty far.
The inside is coming along real well. I think we've already started scheduling, not because it's there yet, but we're probably, less than 2 months away from, for sure, less than 2 months away from staging. So cabinets are either in or going in right now. I know it's painted, of course, sheetrock, all that kind of good stuff. I think the cabinets are either in or they're going in. I think we had a little change we made on the cabinets, so it pushed them back just a touch.
No.
Or maybe they're going to add them after they get out there. Anyway, we'll see. But that's the news for later. That's just a little sneak peek for news for later. But yeah, I would say that the cabinets are probably either there or they're very close to going in. So it's coming along real quick.
Yeah, we're getting close. We're excited on that one. And it is big and beautiful. It is an amazing house. All right.
That is
all the questions I see.
That is all of them, folks. We are so grateful you joined us. Obviously, we're here for you. That's why we do this. Dawn and I talk all the time. We don't have to talk about this stuff. We do this so you guys have this information. You're armed with the best information, the latest information. You ask great questions. We are super, super grateful. tell Eric that my time has come and gone. I did it.
Tried to negotiate with Tilson on Eric. He is a terrible rep.
You missed me. Hey, you're working out of the spring office. You missed me by like 14 years. So, but 14 years ago, Eric, if we were dancing, you'd very likely be one of my customers. I did that for 8 years at that office. Anyway, so, and it's fun. I loved it. I loved every minute of it. So, but yeah, thank y'all for watching. Thank y'all for engaging with us. It doesn't have to end here. We got the award-winning website open 24/7 with new home specialists on standby, not 24/7, but they are on standby to help answer your high-level questions, get you scheduled at any of our design centers. We got, speaking of them, 12 design centers open 7 days a week that we love to see you out there. That's where you would most likely run into Don or me, is mixing it up down there in the sales centers. Then, of course, we have a Facebook page. We have a YouTube channel with googobs, that's a technical term, of information on there for you. Lots of videos, lots of content, lots of customers talking.
180 about, of these.
180 is the 180th one, huh?
180,
yeah. So all that is there for your viewing pleasure. We have an Instagram page that's there. Lots of pretty pictures, lots of happy people. But anyway, go there, get your questions answered. We love to hear from you guys. And we'll see you again real soon. Until then, we really hope to soon make you part of the Tilson family. We'll see y'all later.
Bye, everybody.